He's great. How can you use this one? Shabbat Shalom! Well, I just feel at home here. Everything is in Hebrew. And you all speak Hebrew, right? So I'll share in Hebrew, okay? Well, before I say anything, I just want to honor Rabbi Eric for inviting me. And I brought you a small gift. Rabbi, can you come here up here for a moment? Is it just a moment to honor your rabbi? Is this okay, guys?
Yes.
I didn't have time to wrap it, but I want to give you this. This is, it's the English now, the Hebrew. But I want to give you this anointing oil that is an olive wood made in Israel. You know, it's scented with myrrh and frankincense. I just want to give you this, and I want to bless you. And I pray, our Father, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, that you will continue to anoint Rabbi Eric.
Amen.
To preach the good news.
Amen.
To heal the brokenhearted. Set the captives free. And declare the year of Jubilee. Shnat Yobel. In Yeshua's name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Streets and the shopping malls And the response we see from the Israelis was tremendous. In 1996, we started a home group which became our congregation, Adonai Elohim, the Lord is my shepherd. We started with a small group of people, and it grew and developed to a beautiful, vibrant congregation of Israelis who love Yeshua. As a local pastor, I had also the opportunity to bring this message of salvation of Israel to churches all over the world. In 2010, I was speaking in South Korea, and there I saw the commitment of the Korean people on prayer. And the Lord spoke to me while I was there that He wants me to find a place in building an altar for prayer and worship right downtown Tel Aviv. So as soon as I came back, the Lord led me to open this VIP prayer tower on the 12th floor in Tel Aviv with a purpose to pray for the city and for the salvation of Israel. The Lord put in my heart to share this place with the other pastors in the Tel Aviv area. So I invited them and gave each one of them a key. And since then, this place has been a place of unity, a place of different congregations come together to pray for the salvation of Tel Aviv. Many people don't realize that the reason we face serious problems with poverty. So we opened up a distribution center called Makas Haruka, right here in the heart of Tel Aviv. With the help of social services, we reach out to many poor people. We have Russian immigrants, Holocaust survivors, and single mothers that we're able to give them bags of food on a weekly basis. For the last few years, the Lord has been speaking to us about looking for permanent homes for the needy. We have always been renting spaces for the different ministries all over the city, but because of persecution in Israel towards the Messianic community, many of our landlords in the past have been pressured by the religious groups into ending our contracts. This recently happened to the Gate Center in downtown Tel Aviv. So we've been looking for a home, a place that will expand our ministry, something that will give glory to God and be a blessing to the community around us right here in Tel Aviv. I would like to invite you to get involved. In the summer for our newsletter or magazine, would you prayerfully consider to join us financially to help us to buy a home for the Gate Center right here in Tel Aviv, Jaffa. Thank you. Shalom.
Amen. The good news is that a few months ago we were able to raise the money and buy cash the place with no debts. Hallelujah! God is good. God is good, and now we are in the middle of renovations. In a few months, God willing, we're going to have a grand opening in downtown Tel Aviv. So let's go to Psalm 122, Tehillim. And before I forget that, I want to say that after the service, right there at the table, we have our magazine and also our family brochure of the Gate. And it's in English, it's free for you, so please take them, put them in your Bible, and pray for us, okay? And take as many as you want, they're in English, I cannot take them back home. I'm in Hebrew. See, I believe we live in a special time. Do you believe that?
Yeah.
You better. If you don't, I suggest you come forward and me, Rabbi Eric, we're going to lay hands on you and cast out that unbelief spirit. We live in a prophetic time. I believe that as we look of the destiny of the United States is connected to the destiny of Israel. How come? Your president is moving your embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. God capital forever. Hallelujah. We live in exciting times. As we are celebrating 70 years of independence, a few months ago we celebrated 50 years of the unification of Jerusalem. It's a happy birthday for Israel.
Yes.
We live in exciting, exciting times. So let's go to Psalm 122. In verse 1 it says, I was glad when they said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet have been standing within your gates, O Jerusalem, Yerushalayim. Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together, where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to the testimony of Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Now, I read my Bible in Hebrew. English is my second language. But I want you to know, when I read the Bible in Hebrew, especially the Tanakh, there's such a richness when you study the Hebrew words. So, if you say, oh Avi, it's Hebrew is too difficult. Well, let me encourage you. You already know of so many words in Hebrew already. When you sing hallelujah, you're singing in Hebrew. Hallelujah, let us praise. Yeah, you're a so every time you say hallelujah, you're saying, let us praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Every time you pray, you say amen, you already say Hebrew. You sing in Hebrew, you pray in Hebrew, you're on the right track. Amen. And you know that's the language you're going to speak up there.
Amen.
Not sure about that? Some of you is going to take eternity to learn it, but it's okay. Are we having fun? Good. In verse 6, it says, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. In Hebrew, it's Shalu Shalom Yerushalayim. Now, the word there is Shalu. Now, what is Shalu? Shalu really means inquire, find out, ask. See, God wants us to ask and find out what's happening in Jerusalem so we can pray accordingly. What am I talking about? Well, let me give you an example. Let's say I live in Tel Aviv, Israel, and somebody from America comes to me and says, Avi, please pray for America. And I've never been in America. And I don't know anybody, anything. So I say, okay, Lord, I pray for America. God bless them. Shalom, bye-bye. Do you think this is effective? Oh. What is effective prayer? When we pray specifically. So to pray specifically, you have to find out what's going on. Amen? So I encourage you, if you live here, to come to Israel. How do you come to Israel? You take an airplane from here all the way to Tel Aviv and you land in Ben Gurion Airport. And some of you may just go, oh, let's go to the Kotel, to the Wailing Wall and pray, which is good. But you know that there are more than 3 million Christian pilgrims who come to Israel every year, and they do the Holy Land tour, and they never ever meet a local believer. They see all these dead stones, and they never meet the real living stones. They never even have a chance to meet a local believer, an Israeli, and pray with them. And I'm thinking, what's wrong with those people? It's like me coming to America and go to Orlando to say hi to Mickey Mouse, in case you don't know what I'm talking about, and never meet believers like you and find out what's happening and worship with you and pray with you and find out, how can I pray for you? How can I find out what's going on? Now, that's finding, that's inquiring, that's exactly what I'm talking about. Shalu, find out, so we can pray more specifically. Amen? And then there is a promise in this verse that says, after you pray, after you find out and you inquire, you pray specifically for the peace of Yerushalayim, may they prosper who love you. So those who love you will be prospered. God will bless you and prosper you. Well, if you don't want to prosper and succeed, please don't love us. See, I did research about the word shalom in the Bible. You know that the word shalom is 422 times. Now, I don't have time today to go over all these things, but I'd like to take two or three examples concerning the word shalom. And then I'm going to give you a beautiful testimony. Now, I'll give you a few examples. For example, the word shalom is used in Judges chapter 11. You can check it at home, verse 30. It talks about this guy, Iftach, Jephthah. That he says to God, God, I go to war, but when I return in shalom, then I vow I'll do this and that. So he's using the word shalom there in the context of safety. I'll come back in safety. That's why he's using the word shalom. Another one, I mean, even in the Brit Chadashah, Luke chapter 11, the New Testament, the Lord talks about when your goods are in shalom, in peace. Again, using the word being saved. Another scripture that I love, in 2 Kings chapter 4, talks about this prophet Elisha. And and there was this lady, the Shunammite lady. This Shunammite lady, every time he goes to the north, so she built a room for him to stay. And she was married, and this lady didn't have any kids. So Elisha tells her, well, you're going to have a child. Of course, she was like wondering, wow, he's a man of God. We'll see. And she did have a child, and this child, this boy grew up, and he was working with his father in the fields, and then he died. So they brought this boy to her, and she put him in the room, and then she ran all the way to Galilee to meet this prophet Elisha, and when she came to her, she was very upset, you know, her only boy died, and Elisha tells her, is it well with you? Is it well with your husband and with your boy? And the word he used there is shalom. You see, even today, if you come to Tel Aviv, or you come to Israel, and you want to ask, hey brother, how are you? Give me your hand. We say, ma shlomcha. How is it with your shalom? Is everything okay? How is your peace? Exactly. Or to a girl, I would say, ma shlomech. How are you? And we use the word shalom for talking about well-doing. You're doing okay? Everything okay? Shalom? Hallelujah. Good. So we can continue. So we use the word again, shalom, for well-doing. Then in Genesis, and you can look it up, of course, in Genesis 14:18, remember, Abraham meets Melchizedek, and he comes from the city of Shalem. And it's again the word shalom, the city of peace, Yerushalayim, Jerusalem. So there's so many connections with the word shalom and with the scriptures. Now the one that I want to finish with, which I love very much, is from Isaiah 52. In Ishayahu, our prophet Isaiah 52 verse 7, that's what it says there. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings bad news? Which Bible do you read? Who brings what? Good news. What good news? Who proclaims? Shalom. Who brings glad tidings of good things? Who proclaims salvation? Yeshua. Who says to Zion, your God reigns. Amen. I love this verse. But what we see here in this verse is very clear. That proclaiming shalom and proclaiming Yeshua, they go hand in hand. You know, we live in this world today that many people say, peace, 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 peace. But there is no peace. Oh, just on a piece of paper and everything will be okay. And everything is not okay. And they try to separate shalom from Yeshua. They try to separate peace from salvation. Well, you can't, because they go hand in hand. And there's only one person that fulfills them. And that is Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen? Is there another way?
No.
Only three people said no. Is there another way?
No.
Oh, okay, I'm in the right place. Because if you think there's another way, you better come here. We're going to lay hands on you and pray for you right now. Because Yeshua is the way, the truth, and the life. There is no other way.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So once we got this clear and we agree with the scriptures, now let me share with you a testimony. About a few years ago, one morning we were having an outreach from the coffee shop. We went out to the streets, did some music, and then we had people coming back. And then there was this young man, and he sat with one of the guys, and we fixed him a nice cup of coffee, and they were sharing about Yeshua. And this guy had a lot of chutzpah. And he goes, this is all lies. You're messianic. You tell all these things about this Yeshua, which has nothing to do with that. And I know those things. And I saw that as he was talking so loud. So I came to the table and I looked him straight to the face and I said, why are you saying this? Why are you calling us liars? Who are you? And he goes, I'm Chesed. And I was brought up ultra orthodox Hasidic in Lembrad. My father is a rabbi, and I know those things are, you're lying to me. And I looked at him, he looked very secular. He had shorts, t-shirt, I mean, he didn't look religious at all. He looked very secular. And I looked at him and I said, you sure don't look like a Hasidic Orthodox Jew to me. And he said, oh, okay, let me tell you, I was raised up this way, but as a teenager, I was fed up with religion. I cut my pants, I threw my kippah, and I threw my religious Hasidic clothes, and I am a secular Jew now. And I know all those things you are trying to convince me. This has nothing to do with this. And I said, oh, really? Behemet. So I opened the Tanakh, and I showed him Jeremiah 31:31. I will make a new covenant. Brit Chadashah, I showed it to him. And he goes, what are you showing me? The New Testament of the Christians? I said, this is Jeremiah. No, that's impossible. This is Catholic. I said, oh, are you telling me Jeremiah is Catholic? And he goes, no. I said, that's what you just said. This is our prophet Jeremiah. How dare you? He said, show it to me. He looked. He didn't believe me. He said, I don't believe you. I said, okay. You have a Tanakh at home? You have a Bible? Good. You go back home and you check Jeremiah 31:1, word by word, and I promise you it's going to be exactly the same in your Bible. Then he got up and said, I sure will. I said, good. Are you serious? He said, yes. I said, good. I am dead serious. I'll wait for you tomorrow morning and we'll talk about it. Now he thought I was teasing me. So he went back home that night. He opened his own Tanakh, his own Bible. And he went to Jeremiah 31 and he saw it. And he was in shock. Why? Because he never read the Bible. You know, you think most of the Orthodox Jews read the Bible? Let me tell you, they don't. They do the Torah, the five books, you know. But they don't read the Bible. There's many chapters. They have never even seen it. So he was in total shock. And he couldn't go to sleep. You know, I love it when Jews read the scriptures and can go to sleep. May all 8 million Israelis don't go to sleep at night because of the word of God. Amen? So that night, he didn't know what to do. So he went to his neighborhood, his rich neighborhood, and he went to see the rabbi at night. And the rabbi said, what's wrong with this? You are so bothered. He said, can you give me a minute? I have a question. Sure, come. And he goes to the rabbi and he shows him Jeremiah 31:31. He shows him his rabbi and the rabbi looks at it and goes, oh, I didn't know it's there. Honestly. And he asked him, well, what, you know, I met this guy, Avi Mizrahi, he's a Messianic Jew. And once he said, Yehudi Mishihi, Messianic Jew, man, the rabbi got mad. And he started calling me all kinds of names, Nazis and all these terrible names. And he said, okay. And he said, well, what's the answer? He said, don't worry about it, Chazi, don't worry. When the Messiah will come, we will ask him. Nice way out, huh? So Chazi went home, and he couldn't go to sleep. He was so bothered, because it's also in his Bible. So guess what, the whole night, what I've been doing, I've been praying for him. And in the morning, I was ready for him. I've been praying, waiting for him, and the moment he walked in back in the morning, I looked at him and I said, well, did you check? Yes, I did. I told you. Yes, but by now, Rabbi said, it has nothing to do with your new covenant, with your Yeshua, Jesus. And I said, sit down and be quiet. He obeyed. We sat down and said, would you like a cup of coffee? Sure. Here, free cup of coffee on the house. By the way, in Israel, there is no free coffee, no free refills. Just warn you, just in case, okay? So he sits down on a cup of coffee, and I start sharing the plan of salvation from the Tanakh, from the Torah, to the scriptures. And I want you to know, as we go to the scriptures, I could see his whole countenance changes. I mean, you know, we just would like to argue, but this is what the scriptures say. What do you think? Isaiah 53. Jeremiah 31, Leviticus. And as I go through the scriptures, I could see his whole countenance is changing. Something is happening. But again, we have been praying for him. Amen? When we pray specifically, God answers. Amen. So I could see things are changing in him. And then once he, after a while, he came to a point saying, okay, Avi, I understand what you're saying. In other words, he got it. Yeshua is the Messiah, okay? But that's step number one. Then he goes, well, Avi, listen, I have a question. Yes? You see, a few months ago, I was working in a place and I did a big boo-boo, and the boss fired me. He said he will have nothing to do with me. He fired me, and I've been looking for a job, and I'm really struggling. Do you think that he can provide me a job? I said, sure, no problem. He said, we'll pray. He said, okay. Well, when you have time, you pray. The synagogue. I said, no. Give me your hands, may I please? Give me your hands. We're going to pray right now. And he goes, you don't need a prayer book? I said, don't worry, God doesn't need a prayer book. And I just prayed, Abba Father, Hashem Yeshua Mashiach, provide Chizim with a job, a good job, in Yeshua's name. Amen. That's all. That's all it took. Did you ask for a sign? Give it to him. Within a few seconds, and I'm not exaggerating, there is a phone call in the middle of my Bible study. And you know, Israelis, we are crazy with all these cell phones. You know, in every meeting, you have to tell them, shut your phones off, you know. Anyhow, he answers his phone call, so I wait for him to finish, and this is how it goes. Yes? Yeah, that's me. Yes? Yeah, thank you. He puts it down, and he's totally pale. And I'm like, Chesed, what happened? Is everything okay? Somebody died in your home? What happened? He goes, no, everything is okay. He said, you will not believe what happened. I said, what? Remember I told you I work in this job there, the windows, and I did a boo-boo, and the landlord fired me, and he said, it had nothing to do with me. And he just called. He did. Yes, he just called, and he asked me if I'm still looking for a job. And I said, yes. And he said, if I want, I can start tomorrow morning. And I said, really? They go, yeah, really. And I looked and I said, do you remember what we just prayed? And he was speechless. Now that's a miracle for a Jew. He's speechless. He doesn't know what to argue. He knew. We prayed. Within seconds, God answered. And now he's under the conviction of the power of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. He looks to me and I look to him. He said, okay, Avi, what must I do? I said, just give me your hand. And we just pray right there. He accepted Yeshua. He's his Messiah. Savior. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, why am I telling you this? Because as soon as we did this, then he came to our congregation and we just loved on him. And he got a job, and we discipled him, and we did the immersion, the mikveh, and everything. He was doing great. But then, a few days, he went to his, he met his father. Listen to this. He went home. His father is a rabbi and busy. But one evening, he was at home, and he came, and his father looked at him, and he said, Chesed, I see a change. You're so happy. I can see a lighting. What happened? And Chesed said, I love God. And his father said, well, it's about time. Come on, let's get you some new clothes and start rising and be like a real Orthodox Jew, you know? And Chesed said, stop. You don't understand. I found the Messiah. Yeah, we Jews, we believe in Messiah. Wait a minute, what Messiah? What are you talking about? He said, Daddy, I found Yeshua as my Messiah. Amen. His father hid the sin. He said, you're no longer my son. Get up. So the first thing we had to do, to find a home for him. And, of course, to love him and all those things. But then, his father got very angry, and he called the Yad Lachem, the anti-missionaries. And then they start standing outside the coffee shop. And every day, all they would do is sit there, shout and scream and curse us. So they curse us, and we bless them. They curse us, we bless them. They're angry at us, and we smile. Yeshua loves you. You see? I read the end of the book. Have you read the end of the book? we're on the winning side. Hallelujah. Greatest in us that is in the world. And nothing can separate us, we just say, from the love of God in Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen?
Amen.
You see, we live in exciting, exciting times.
Amen?
Amen. So, we need to be bold on our feet. And every opportunity, like you shared earlier, Rabbi, every opportunity God gives us, God gives us that opportunity, go for it. Because we have the answer. We don't have the answer to all the questions, but we have the answer. And the answer is Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen?
Amen?
Now what's happening in Israel? I tell you, we live in exciting times. We are gonna celebrate next month 70 years of independence, and things are happening in Israel. I tell you, Jews and Arabs are coming to faith like we have never seen before. What am I talking about? You know, last year, a group of Jewish and Arab believers from Israel, we flew to Thessaloniki, Greece. Why did we fly there? Because we heard there is a big refugee camp from Syria and Iraq, right there outside of the city of Thessaloniki. Thousands of refugees, Muslims, living in tents. So we went there, a group of Jewish and Arab believers, group from our congregation and a group from our brother, Pastor Nizar from Nazareth, Arabic pastor. We joined together, we prayed together, and we flew to Thessaloniki in Greece, and we met in a house. There was a small house of prayer there. We prayed, and then we went to that camp. This camp, thousands of tents and thousands of people. And we went there as an NGO, and we went there just to give t-shirts, clothes, and food. And then we let the Arab brothers from Israel speak to them in Arabic. We'll just be silent and quiet and pray. And then the next day we said, we'll come and pick you up, and we have in our house of prayer, we have food, we have clothes for the children, games and fun things and activities. Come. So the next day we'll come, and many mothers with children, because either they were single mothers, the husband died in the war, or the husband would go and work, do all kinds of work to bring some money in. To make a long story short, we went every morning for a few days. Every morning we brought, I don't know, 30 to 40 Muslim Arabs. And when they came, they were very suspicious of us, but we just welcomed them with a big smile, gave them a nice meal, gave them some clothes, and we did activities for the children, and we sang with the children, and you could see a big smile coming to their face. And then the Arab believers start sharing the gospel with them. And then they will say, but what about them? Well, they're Jewish believers from Israel. And they go, Jews from Israel? Say, no, they are our brothers. And we join the Arab brothers. And here they saw a Jew and an Arab loving one another. And we said, we came on our own all the way from Israel to serve you. You know what happened? Those Muslim refugees, they start crying. He said, nobody cares for us. And you came from Israel, Jews and Arabs? You've come to do this for us free? Yes, and we said, yes. You know why we did this? Because Yeshua loves you. And we love you. Because Yeshua is the Prince of Peace. Only through him, through Yeshua, the Prince of Peace. The prophet that was even said in the Quran, he spoke the truth. He's the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes from God but through him. And you know what? Every day, we pray with Muslims refugees to accept Yeshua as the Savior. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you, we live in exciting times. And you need to be connected with what God is doing nowadays. You know, if you want to hear bad news, go and watch CNN. But I've come this morning to bring you good news. I've come to tell you that we're seeing, you know, I've been involved the last few years in a movement called Isaiah 19 Highway. You can go home and read Isaiah 19, where he talks about it, the highway from Egypt to Assyria. And the end of the chapter, it talks about Israel, Egypt, and Assyria being one serving the Lord. How can this happen? Only through Yeshua.
Amen.
You need to know all over the Middle East, God the Holy Spirit is revealing himself to so many Muslims through dreams and visions, and they're coming to the Lord. And one thing that I love to see when they get saved and get born again, the first thing they have to deal with their hatred towards Israel, and God changes their heart and they love Israel.
Amen.
I tell you, this is a strong testimony to Israelis. When they meet an ex-Muslim or ex-Hamas guy that was hating Jews and want to kill Jews, and now he loves Jewish people. Do we have a minute for another testimony as well? Okay, I'll share this because I think you will love this testimony. I'll finish with that. One morning, I'm opening the gate, the coffee shop, and I have this guy coming, and he says, "My name is Suhail." And right away I knew he's Arab, Palestinian. And I said, "Halam salam, I want to fix a cup of coffee." "Yeah, sure, halam salam." Fix him a cup of coffee. Then he looks to me like very, you know, suspicious. He said, "Well, last night I was in the beach and some of your friends were playing guitars on the beach and they told me to come here for a free cup of coffee." I said, "Welcome." "Well, I have a story. I have some questions." I said, "Go ahead." And he told, this is his story. He said, "I was born in a Muslim family in Hebron. When I was born, my mother died, so my father married other women. You know, in Islam, they can marry many women. Okay, so he said, I was really, didn't know my father, and I was disowned. So I, when I was a young boy, I joined the Muslim Brotherhood. And they taught me how to become a suicide bomber." And I thought, great. I have a suicide bomber in my coffee shop. I mean, this is great. So he's telling me this story. And he said, "Well, one day my friend was preparing a bomb and exploded and he killed my friend and it shook me and I said, I want nothing to do with Islam. So I left the Muslim Brotherhood, so I left Hebron because I knew that they would go after me and I went to Bethlehem because in Bethlehem there are many Christians there." So he went to Bethlehem. Well, guess what? The Muslim Brotherhood went after him to Bethlehem. And he said, "One day I walked and this Muslim Brotherhood came and saw me and asked me to come back and I said no. So they beat me up, they stabbed me and they left me bleeding on the street. I almost died. Somebody called the ambulance, they took me to the hospital and I was recuperating for a month in the hospital. And when I got better, I decided, well, this Muslim Brotherhood are not going to leave me alone. So I sneaked in over the border and came to Tel Aviv. So I'm working in a restaurant washing dishes. And at night I just stay in by the beach and that's how I met your friends. Singing praises to God, to Allah." I said, "Okay." And then he goes this, listen to this. He goes, "I'll take what you say." It's okay. He looks to me, you know, in Israel we're not like in America, you take space. You know what I mean? In America people like space. When we get serious in Israel, there is no space. And he goes very close and he goes, "Avi, why Allah, why God hates me?" And I realized, all this guy has learned all his life, God of hate and violence. That's all he knows. And when he said this to me, I just knew, this is it. I just looked at him and I said, "God doesn't hate you, God loves you. God has a beautiful plan for your life. Satan, oh, he hates you. He wants to kill you and destroy you. But God loves you. He has a future and a hope for you. He has a beautiful plan for you. And I love you." And you know what happened? This guy stopped crying. This Palestinian Muslim is crying. And I just gave him a big hug. And I this song gave him a big hug. And he was just crying over my shoulders. And when he finished crying, he looks to me and said, "Avi, what must I do?" I said, "Just pray with me." And I took his hands and he prayed to accept Yeshua as his Savior. And you know, when he came to our congregation, here is a Palestinian Muslim, ex-Muslim, worshiping, singing in Hebrew, Yeshua HaMashiach, praising and worshiping with us. And then later on, we discipled and baptized him. Let me explain to you. I was in the army. I was 4 years in the Israeli Air Force. Here am I, an Israeli Sabra, born and raised in Israel, served 4 years in the Israeli Air Force, and I'm baptizing, immersing an ex-Muslim Palestinian who was trained to be a suicide bomber. and now is worshiping Yeshua with us. This is what God is doing in Israel. Aren't you excited? Hallelujah! Exciting times. And I'm here to encourage you to keep praying for us. When you come to Israel, come and visit us. And we'd love to have you in our prayer tower. We'd love to have you in our congregation. And if you behave, we'll teach you some Hebrew Israeli dances as well.